Care. Chidambaram Academy of Refinement and Enrichment was started on 5th September 2006 and named after the renowned freedom fighter Mr. V.O. Chidambaranar of Thoothukudi. The main objective of CARE is societal development through human resource development. We have an easy accessibility. CARE has 11 zonal offices across South India, namely Madurai, Tiruchi, Kovai, Vellur, Chennai, Hosur, Puduvai, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Karnataka, and Kerala. Services offered by CARE. Training and development. Guidance and counseling. Legal support. Treatment, other services like corporate films and training videos, corporate magazines, GST services and training, translation works, even management, and CSR activities. All our activities and services are guided under our founder director CARE, Dr. R. Krishnamurthy, professor, psychologist, trainer, advocate, and social worker. And also by our joint director CARE, Mr. S. Balachandar, director, ELM World Academy, Hosur. You can contact us through the given mobile numbers. Also visit our website for more information. You can write us for any queries in the following mail IDs. Join us through social media by subscribing our YouTube channel for free motivational videos, CARE HRD for Success. All our online sessions is also being shared in the YouTube channel. Also find us in Facebook, CARE HRD India. Now, to formally welcome the chief guest, may I request him to please accept the bouquet.
Welcome, sir. Welcome to CARE.
Thank you very much.
Welcome, sir.
Welcome, sir. Now, may I request Dr. Kamala Kannan to please accept the bouquet.
Welcome, madam. Welcome.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Welcome. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you, Sahana. Next is inaugural address and introduction of the speaker by our guest, Dr. Kamala Kannan, madam, founder director. Academy Hosur. Over to you, madam.
Thank you very much, Gita and Sahana. Good evening to all. I thank CARE Academy and Dr. Krishnamurthy for giving me an opportunity to speak about our today's guest speaker, Mr. Ganesha Subramanian, founder director of Ganesh IAS Academy. Welcome, sir. He is a postgraduate in physics and public administration. And he has started his IAS Coaching Academy, Ganesha's Coaching Academy, he said, in 2001. It's the first professional coaching IAS center academy for in Tamil Nadu. I know some even in the early 90s, many people used to go to Delhi, stay there to prepare for their IAS. All the IAS aspirants will go there. The IAS preparation itself is a very, you have to, 24 hours is not sufficient, that much hard work it requires. Besides that, they have to bear with the climate of Delhi, which is not used for Tamil Nadu people, the food and the expenses they have to make at staying, for staying, everything. So this was a dream for many people that we would, if an IAS academy is in Tamil Nadu, that would, many people would be benefited. So Mr. Ganesha Subramanian sir has made it possible for Tamil Nadu. Thank you very much, sir, for that. And he regularly writes articles and columns on current topics in the Hindu, and he's a motivational speaker to various schools and colleges. And he has penned a book on Indian polity and constitution by Pearson Publications. These are all the things I would like to say about our guest speaker. I just browsed about that Gias. So I was really shocked, sir. The help you have given to so many people, 1500 in who have cleared UPSC, 137 in cleared IAS, and 116 IPS, 53 IFS, 268 IRS, and 467 in TNPSC. Great, great achievement. Really, people who have done all these things are very lucky and blessed to have you as a trainer. And your services is needed for Tamil Nadu for much more people in this cracking these examinations. I wish you all the best, sir.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, madam. That was a wonderful and apt introduction. And next, the secret announcements. Type your doubts in the chat box that will be clarified by the trainer at the session. Raise your hands in the question answer session. You will be unmuted and you can ask your doubts and your feedback with us. You can cover your name, WhatsApp number, and ready to have for the updates of our program. Is everything said? All make a lot of spaces in your mind for today's session. Since our Ganesha sir is ready to do a lot of things today, Ganesha sir, we are ready today. The stage is all yours. Rock the floor. Ganesha sir, you can share your screen.
Yeah, I can start. Thank you. Thank you very much, CARE Foundation. Thank you, Krishnamurthy sir, for giving me the opportunity. And thank you, Kamala ma'am, for introducing me. And thank you, Sahana and Geeta, for coordinating the entire program. And the participants, I thank you at the outset. And I wish you all the best before we go into the presentation. Basically, I've been introduced very well. You all know my full name is Ganesha Subramanian, and I teach public administration, Constitution of India and Indian Polity, and ethics for civil services examination. And after the session also, if you have any questions, any doubts regarding civil service exams as well, you can talk to me. And why I'm telling this to you is because we have a paper called Ethics, Integrity and Aptitude in Civil Service Examination. And this topic, I insisted to myself to prepare the topic in such a manner that it will be helpful for students who appear in the main examination this year. Because this is one of the very important events that has shaken the globe. And it has also, in English, they have a term called epoch-making events. This is one such epoch-making event. An epoch-making event is one that will have an impact on every aspect of the society. It will have the ability to influence the thought process of the society itself, and value transmissions, value transitions will take place when such an epoch-making incident will take place. Certain epoch-making incidents, I can quote example as World Wars, the two World Wars, then globalization. It changed the very thinking of the society. COVID, I see this as one such event. In fact, COVID is sometimes referred to as a black swan event. You must have come across a black swan event. It's more than an epoch-making event. It's more apt to call it as a black swan event. A black swan event is one which will be extremely rare, unpredictable, with serious consequences, with severe consequences. At times, even the however robust modeling system you have, the system cannot prevent it. Whatever system you are having, the system may not be capable of preventing that. And it will have the potential to cause catastrophic damages to the economy. It will have very severe negative impact on the investment in the markets and the investments. The investor confidence will be broken. And even the most difficult aspect of it, or most important thing, is that the standard forecasting tools not only fail to predict such black swan events, but they can also potentially increase the vulnerability. Not every black swan event has to be negative. There are certain black swan events which could be also positive, but unfortunately, COVID we are facing today is a negative black swan event, a rare, extremely rare event that has taken place. And why it happened, who was responsible, there are several theories. We are not focusing on those aspects as far as this discussion is concerned. We are going to confine ourselves. The scope of our discussion will be more confined to the ethics aspect of the COVID. How COVID-19 has impacted upon the ethics, whether we have gained anything ethically with respect to the ethics or whether we have lost. In a way, we have gained few and we have lost few. Let us try to understand one by one. First, we'll try to understand what actually we have gained. First, what we have gained is the realization. The realization of one of the importance of ethical values. There are two important things which you would have come across, very common terms, namely equity and justice. In our society, in society like that of India, and more so, it is a global phenomenon as well, there are people who do not have access to resources, access to benefits, and they are deprived due to several reasons, and certain reasons are more relating to the social reasons and the structural reasons. That's what we call as structural reasons. The COVID has brought out the most important inequity prevailing, which is the health inequity. The health inequity is nothing but an avoidable difference in the health outcomes due to unequal distribution of power, money, and resources that systematically disadvantage some individuals and groups in a society. We realize that until now, it was thought that health equity was more, it was a natural phenomenon. Now we have realized, the society has realized, although the economist and the public administrationist policymakers might have understood this, now the society is understanding this. More importantly, the society, the common man is now understanding and realizing that health inequity, the inequity in society, and more so the health inequity in the society, is not a natural phenomenon, but it is the result of structural injustice. In fact, structural injustice is something, it is a systematic thing that makes things systematically go disadvantages to certain people. Some of you who would have studied management and some of you who would have studied sociology and political science could have come across John Rawls' theory of justice. John Rawls in 1960s came out with the theory of justice, in which he says, in every society there are two important phenomena, two important concepts that each society must focus on. One is the equality of everybody, and the other is the equitable distribution of resources, access to resources and benefits. And he says very clearly, if there occurs a conflict between equity and equality, it is essential for equity to be retained and equality can be compromised for an interregnum, during when the equality will be result of achieving equity. Until now, we thought that health inequity was more because of the social irresponsible behavior, or people not able to earn what they have to, and they are not maintaining their health and sanitation. It is because of their living condition that they create for themselves. But COVID has made us realize that the health inequity was more because of the structural injustice. The migrant labor, refugees, unemployed, homeless people, and others, those who have very limited access to basic health care, are all more vulnerable to COVID kind of conditions, COVID kind of diseases, infections. And there's more possibility that they may die. It did not happen in India. Singapore, which we all consider as a model town and model city, and we want to reorganize our cities, Indian cities, like that of Singapore. Singapore faced this problem. And Singapore had the problem. In Singapore, the migrant workers, most of the migrant workers who came from China and India, they were all living in very densely populated dormitories. And their although they have insurance, although they have healthcare systems put in place, they were not, those healthcare systems could not satisfy the demand that was created by COVID. And Singapore had to, the Singapore government had to press into, press more resources in order to cater to those migrant laborers. If that is the case with respect to Singapore, then just imagine what it would have been for India. And think of the European countries where the fatality was too high. Take the case of Spain, take the case of Italy, take the case of Germany, take the case of UK. They themselves were stumbling and fumbling to manage the COVID situation, and they could not prevent fatalities. Fortunately, in India, the fatal rate is only about 3%, close to 3% of the infected population. Probably by nature, our immunity system is much more stronger than the European immunity system. Or there is another theory stating that the COVID that came to India is less virulent. Whatever be the reasons, luckily we did not have much of fatality. But we understood that if we are not going to set right this structural injustice, which is resulting in health inequity, we are going to get into trouble. So this realization of the importance of equity as a value, as an ethical value, and justice as an ethical value, percolating down to the individuals, is one that we have gained at the outset, at the first. This is what I had already told you. Previously, it was thought that the structural injustice was basically because of the, is an outcome of the individual's failure, his laziness, his unwillingness to contribute to society, etc. But now, after COVID, we understand that it is not so. It is more because of the deliberate arrangements that are prevalent in the society, and each one of us are contributing to the perpetuation of this structural injustice because of our engagements in its elements. For instance, we have been contributing to the structural injustice, which means, if I can put it across this way, the structural injustice is nothing but the prevalent wide gap between rich and the poor, where the poor are not poor because they are born poor, but because of the lacuna in the society, in the social order, in the manner in which the economy is being managed. That we have realized. Until now, the common man thought that poor are poor because they are not working very hard. We had, see, in the common, let us think in the common way, very ordinary manner. What was our opinion when we saw an auto driver when you come to Chennai, land in Chennai Central Station or Chennai Airport or in Coimbatore bus stand? What will be your first encounter with the auto wallas? And your first encounter will definitely be a nightmare for you. And we had a very negative opinion about the auto wallas, stating that they are all criminals. Their behavior was also, to some extent, their behavior was also conforming to that, and we could not defend if somebody is forming an opinion of that sort. So we thought that because of their attitude, because of their negative attitude, because of their declining attitude and the way they handle their customers, they were poor, and it was because of that reason. Now we realize it is the other way around. Their behavior is outcome of the injustice which is causing an inequity. It is not that because of the behavior they are suffering, but it's because of the suffering their behavior is like that. Previously, it used to be told by many, but we may not be in a position to understand. Now, people have begun to realize that. Let us wait and see whether we have gained what we have gained. This realization is going to become a workable, practicable condition or not, we do not know. Let us expect the hope and move on. The next realization is the elimination of this structural injustice. We understood very clearly that. We realized that there is a welfare role for the state in eliminating the structural injustice, and we have begun to understand the importance of government and the state. During the unemployment, during the lockdown triggered unemployment. Irrespective of whether you are employed in a software company, earning a 5-digit or 6-digit salary, or if you are a rickshaw puller, whoever you are, you were forced to look up to the government and the central role of the state in making such sufferings, in mitigating such sufferings was realized by the population, the importance of the government. At least now, this generation which has passed through this COVID situation will understand that bureaucracy has its own relevance. Even if you call somebody, there used to be a caller tune in which they say police are the heroes, the health workers are the heroes, the doctors are the heroes, we have to respect them. So the point I want to drive home is very, very simple. We realize that bureaucracy is not always bureaucratic, but bureaucracy is many a time performing certain services, rendering certain services, and their services have been now realized and recognized. As a consequence into the society, we also realized that the consumerist behavior has only contributed to the greediness in the society. And such greediness is not going to benefit anybody in the society. And in fact, we have realized that instead of being a consumerist, globalized citizen, we have to be a localized, local player. You all must have come across the call that the Prime Minister gave, think local and act local. And people have realized today that it is more important to give, because giving gives. When you give to somebody, it will come back to you in another coin. That it's not reciprocated in the same coin, but it will be given. You will get it back in another coin. So people realize that this is time to give. You can find many people, everybody, most of us, we did not bother to, although we stopped the maids, we had housemaids. We had people who will come regularly, broom our floors, wipe them off, mop them off, wash our utensils, help us in the household chores. We stopped them because fearing COVID. When you stop them, you might have had n number of complaints against your housemaid. And the housemaid, she herself would have got n number of complaints against you. She would have been gossiping about you below your flat, roaming around here and there, talking ill about you. But during COVID, just imagine, people understood that because of COVID, I cannot let the housemaid in. I have to take care of my household chores on my own. But yet, where will she go? I will pay her the money. I will pay her the salary, even if she does not come to the job. Even if I am not engaging her, even if I am not taking her services, I'll pay for her. And on the contrary, you will find they also began to realize that it is the time when the interdependence of the human beings is only going to be working and the independence is not going to be practicable. And you can find the voluntary organizations like Rotary Clubs, Lions Clubs, and various other NGOs. They were very active collecting and distributing the relief to the migrant workers, street dwellers, orphans, etc. And more importantly, the most important is this point, the middle class, we the middle class, realized the humiliation behind, the loss of dignity behind, and the stigma associated with receiving something from somebody. We all had the ego. The ego triggered. See, in the globalization, after the globalization, we became consumers rather than citizens. We became consumers rather than individuals. The society was more viewed as a market. Right? If you open the TV in the morning, right from the brushing of your teeth till you sleep, there are n number of products. And if you sit and watch the television for one whole day, all the advertisements collectively, and if you watch, end of the day, you will find that we are all unfit to live, and we are living a life that is absurd, and we have to live with the products and the manner in which the marketing guys have designed. That's what we used to believe. That's what we are given to believe. This has made us to become consumers. We have been, our minds have been engineered that you are a consumer. India is a big market, huge market. And the fancy term called opportunity and development was used to sell this concept to us. People tell you that you have to develop. And for development, you need opportunity. And for opportunity, you require globalization. And what happened? It resulted in consumerism. Each one of us became a consumer. The consumer behavior, the consumerist behavior, I'm not talking about consumer, I should not say the consumer behavior. It is the consumerist behavior resulted in the maximal life, which led to the rise of greediness. We never gave. We always wanted more. More and more, bigger and bigger. At that rat race, in that rat race, we never understood what it would be if you don't have. What it would be if you were to go to receive help from anyone else. It could be your family members. It could be your family members. Got my point? See, you must have come across something called as gig economy. The gig economy. The gig economy, the youngsters of today, the younger generation of today, the 90s kids and the millennium kids, they always had, if I'm permitted, and with an apology, I may use this term. Youngsters here, please don't mistake me. You are more considered to be very demanding, more demanding, and you're more egoistic, and you have a know-it-all attitude, because you can earn. Job was found every round there, every round, every corner around you find, you will be able to find a job. I'll go to a BPO, I'll go to a KPO, I'll become a Swiggy delivery boy, I'll become a Dunzo delivery boy. I can earn 1,000 rupees a day, that's enough for me. You never had the vision, but COVID brought us down. It brought us down. Life is not about living today. Life is about living every day, and life is about having a vision. If you don't have that vision, you will have to go at times to go behind somebody. And now the middle class understood that. What will be the humiliation of getting something? Giving is pride, but getting is humiliating. That giving is more dignitarious, but receiving is, it costs us some sort of mental, a sort of a mental pain. The stigma associated with getting things, that is now realized. And that was the reason why people began to give. But we have to hope, fingers crossed, but we have to hope that this behavior will continue and the consumerist behavior will be subsiding and we will more move towards a minimalist living. We'll hope for the best. Then you can find this again. The landlords accepting that the house, landlords and house owners accepting that fine, you are not able to pay the rent. So you don't pay. They waived the rent. They waived the rent. And the tenants also feeling committed to pay the rent. This is a change. This is one realization which we have gained. Giving gives. So you have to give. You have to be interdependent. And you have to be responsible. Then the next realization is the importance of relationship. We have begun to understand the importance of human relationship. Anyone who has done management and who has studied George Elton Mayo's human relations theory, which arose during the First World War, end of the First World War. In US, after the First World War, many organizations had very high rate of worker turnover. Workers leaving job. They could not understand what is happening in the organizations. Why do they go? when even people, when the company, the organization was ready to pay more, double, three times the normal salary, people did not want to come and work. It was at this juncture, George Elton Mayo, one of the management thinkers from Harvard, he came, a psychologist, a doctor and psychologist by profession. He undertook a study and he brought out that human beings are a bundle of sentiments and emotions, and without emotions, without addressing their emotions, without addressing to their, catering to their values, people will not work for the organization at all. It is a value. Less a similar thing, because Elton Mayo, he used as a term, he conducted an experiment. He inquired the employees over there in the Continental Mills, in a company called Continental Mills, where the worker turnover was to the tune of about 250%. You want to make 100 people work, you have to recruit 250 people. So Elton Mayo, he studied them and he was able to understand, he was able to bring out one important thing. The workers had only one complaint: the job and the overtime which the organization insists to perform is not allowing us to spend good time with my family. The worker's complaint was that I am not able to spend my social evenings. Elton Mayo calls it as social evenings. There he understood, the worker showed that he realized the importance of the relationship. He realized the importance of being with human beings. During the First World War, people have gone to the brink of death and come back. Neck of the moment, it's a snick of the moment, they would have died this way or that way. Seeing death, they understood that there is no point in running behind money, and they wanted to increase the family bonding. And in a country like India, where we always, our social structure is based on family, and we have family bonding is a very natural phenomenon, we were losing it. During the last 25 years of globalization, we were losing it. There used to be the breakdown of the joint family system. Nucleated families came. The privacy and individualism was given more importance. I'm not saying that privacy and individualism is not required, it's not needed. They are needed, very much needed. At the same time, we have to understand the importance of human relationship. COVID has made us to understand that. The COVID triggered lockdown, forced us to remain at home. So we began to understand each other. We began to see what the mother was doing, what the father was doing, what my son was doing, what my child was doing. And in Chennai kind of urban centers, until now, the apartment complexes, there used to be a complaint. People don't even know who their neighbors are. Who lives in my opposite house, I will not have any clue. Even if we are, you know, crisscrossing in a mall, we will not be realizing that we are neighbors. But COVID situation and the lockdown gave us the opportunity to not only know who my neighbor is, it also gave me the opportunity to understand what he was doing, understand what company he was working for, what his family values are, how he is running his family, what are his problems. It has developed, it has given the opportunity to develop friendship. Clear? Which means COVID has made us to understand what is empathizing with people. What is empathizing with people? You are empathizing with the poor. You are empathizing with your own family members. You are empathizing with your neighbors. Right? Your bias is removed. You are now coming out with open mind to understand people, because you understand being related is the human value. Man is basically a social animal. Man cannot live without another man. At least according to Sigmund Freud, you require somebody to call as enemy. Even enemy is a relation. So we realized it thanks to COVID. Next important thing, what COVID has given and what we gained is the opportunity to transfer the values to the next generation. Again, with an apology to the 90s kids and 2000 kids, millennium kids here in this meeting participants. You people have seen, I would prefer to call you people as globalization children, born after the globalization phenomenon, you cannot imagine a house without a television. You can only imagine a house with a television, and that too, a wall-mounted one, LED. And now your bothering is more about how many inches it is. Is it 65 inches or 42 inches? You cannot imagine a house without furnitures. I hope you get my point. You had restaurants, you had partying, chilling out, to use your terms, chilling out, cool buddies. The cool buddies did not understand, or they did not have the opportunity to understand part of the responsibilities with our generation as well. We have seen both sides. We have seen household, we have lived during our childhood times, we never had televisions. That when we were in the schools, television entered to the village, not to the houses. Today, television has become more than a member in the house. We are, whether you have a bedroom or not, or you plan for constructing a house, you plan for a room for the television as well. It's called as home theater. It's called as home theater. Remember, one of the important studies by the National Crime Records Bureau, after the Delhi gang rape case, Nirbhaya case, says that the increasing violence against women is because of the erosion of values and ethics, particularly because of the weakening of the family system, and particularly weakening of the concept called home. Previously, the home was a home. Today, the home is not a home. It is a place for boarding and lodging. It is a place for playing. It is a place for entertainment, watching movies and serials. And it is also a place where socialization, acculturation, and relationship development takes place. When a child grows in this atmosphere, the transference of the values doesn't take place. The ethical, moral framework of the child does not get strengthened. As a result, he gets influenced through negative influences and he does not respect life. The kind of objectification of women that is being done in the media, be it advertisements, be it mass media, be it cinema, whatever it is. Nobody is bothered about what a male news reader wears. Just imagine, we are all educated. We all are matured. We claim to be matured. But just think about our ethical mindset, ethical framework. Are we bothered about what a male news reader? We are watching news. Remember, we are watching news. We are not watching an entertainment. We are not watching a movie. We are not watching a feature film. Even when we watch a news, we need a sort of an entertainment value where we are more bothered about the blouse design of the news reader, right? The earrings, what she wears. Think about this one, what do you call that? In Tamil, we call it as kottu. That matters. If we are going to see, this is another way of our, this is one of the unknowingly, unwittingly, we are objectifying a woman who has come to read the news and who has come to transfer knowledge. Have we ever realized that? No. This is exactly what the National Crime Record Bureau said. Your home should be a home. COVID made that possible. The home became home. It gave an opportunity for everybody to sit together, right? And for the 90s and millennium kids, the globalization children, who were more chilling out with burgers and pizzas, they were forced to taste the home food. They realized what is being a parent, what is being a mother, what is being a father, what is being a grandfather, what is being a grandmother. And because of this interaction, the transference of values is possibly taking place, and we hope for the best that it takes place continuously. And as of now, please, participants, do you have any questions? Are you comfortable with the way I am going on? Shall I go in the same way?
Yes, sir. Very, very good. Very simple language and slow delivery, sir. Super.
Thank you. Now we shall continue. The next thing what we have gained is relating to work ethics. The employees have understood what the problem of the employers, and they have accepted the reduction in salary without frowning of faces, which has made the employers much more responsible. The employers are now being more committed to retain the employees than using this opportunity. This is exactly what F.W. Taylor, again, management, those people who have studied management, you would have come across this person, this thinker, F.W. Taylor, who is called as a father of scientific management. He talks about something called as mental revolution. Mental revolution, according to Taylor, is that the worker and the management should understand that their interests are not mutually exclusive. What you are, previously the workers and the management, they thought that the management will exploit the worker, and the management was of the view that the worker will always cheat. Taylor said, no, you should first of all remove that. Your interest is in the other person's interest. Unless and otherwise you both work together, you will not work scientifically. To some extent, COVID has brought that out, that mental revolution has come. The workers understand that the employers cannot pay because there is no revenue, complete lockdown. The employers understand that without their support, the employees cannot survive. So there is a strengthening of work ethics. Today, people's commitment towards work has increased. There is a positive change with respect to this commitment. Similarly, certain jobs which were considered, hitherto which were considered manual and mean, have got their recognition. Think of the garbage and sewage cleaners, the health workers. You must have seen during the beginning of the COVID phase, during the first phase of the lockdown and all, we found that the garbage cleaners being, garlanded, flowers being spilt over them. These are all some of the things you have to remember. The work ethics has improved. There is a positive change in the work ethics. There are no ugly jokes about the doctors and the nurses. You find in the magazines, in the journals, you see. Previously, there were two professionals who were the pivot of joke writers. One was the doctors, the other was doctors and associated institutions, and the other were policemen. Just see. In the past 6-7 months, during the lockdown, during the COVID phase, we have begun to salute the doctors. We have begun to salute the nurses. We have begun to salute the health workers. And police are more respected today. The work ethics has improved in that way. Similarly, another thing what we have gained is a new fundamental right. The right to have a dignified funeral. Because of the nature of COVID and the speed, the rate at which it used to spread, any patient who died out of COVID, the dead body was not handed over to the relatives and family. It was more cremated by the government institutions only. Regarding this, a public interest litigation was filed in the High Court of Madras in 2020, September. The court came out with the judgment stating that the right to life guaranteed by Article 21 of the Constitution of India includes not only the right to live with human dignity and right to die with human dignity, but also to also a right to have a dignified funeral. You have the right to have a funeral with dignity. So we have gained that. So we have gained that as well, a fundamental right we have gained. So this much we have gained out of COVID. These are all very positive things. But society is again a very, how to say, I cannot call it as a, it's very a mysterious thing. It will realize at one point in time, we will have all positive ideas that it's going to be, the society has changed, but social changes are invisible. And social changes, once people become used to it, it becomes used to it, and it will no more be observable. And I wish, and we all wish, that this, whatever we have gained, will percolate into our minds. It will get imbibed. We get inculcated these ethical values, and we continue to live that way. On the other hand, there are certain other things which we have lost as well. What we have lost, we'll see. With respect to medical ethics, there have been hospitals which has used COVID as an opportunity to make money, expand their buildings, construct more buildings, etc. And the hospitals were, again, structural injustice. The hospitals were choosy about the patients. Many hospitals refused to admit patients who could not pay money. And many hospitals did not supply ventilators, even if it was available, to people who did not pay money. And there were allegations against hospitals that they have stolen organs from the patients admitted for some other ailment under the garb of COVID. You get admitted to any hospital for some other ailment, they will simply say that they'll take a COVID test. They say that you are a COVID positive, isolate you, put you in the ICU. Obviously, when it is COVID positive, it's only a piece of paper that the report has to be shown to you. That's it. You have to believe it. Now, there have been organ theft. Recently, there was a hospital in Tanjore where the hospital claimed that the patient was COVID, and they themselves arranged for the burial of the patient. But the patient's family members, they moved the Madurai bench of Madras High Court, filed a case against the hospital, because they said that the hospital in Tanjore, the hospital has charged them 18 lakhs. Just imagine, what is 18 lakhs in Tanjore for COVID? We all know very well that for COVID, there is no medicine. After all, it is going to be a combination of paracetamol, zinc, and azithral or erythromycin, hot water, something called as kabasura kudinir. And for one PPE kit, they say 10,000 rupees. So it's greediness. So, sir, you may feel that, sir, this is all, what is new in this? Always the corporate hospitals are like this. Why are you putting it here as if that we have lost? Why I am taking this as what we have lost is because there is something called as public health ethics. And every doctor, he takes Hippocrates' oath. The four important principles of Hippocrates' oath and public health ethics is autonomy, beneficence, non-maleficence, and justice. That your should be autonomy of the patient. The patient should be given freedom to choose. And it should be beneficence, benefit to the society at large. And it should not be with malefied intention. And it should promote justice. The Indian Council of Medical Research adds on to these four. There are other principles like social justice, solidarity, reciprocity, accountability, and transparency. All these principles are violated, flouted at the time of a crisis. See, you can charge more to people who can afford during the normal times, but at the time of emergency, it's really boiling down to a question of declining ethics. Are we into a society where, a society where the doctors and the hospitals are institutions of reliability and dependability? That's now being questioned. Similarly, we all know that we are all expecting a vaccine for COVID. But the general life cycle of the development of a vaccine is about 3.5 years. They have to test it first upon the animals, then upon the human beings. Then there are several steps. Now, because of the gravity of the situation, the governments have relaxed the processes with respect to the development of COVID vaccine. This has resulted in the accelerated testing. And in this accelerated testing, the human beings upon whom the drug is tested, there should be some sort of beneficence to society, transparency, accountability. But are they used only for testing the COVID medicine or something else? Nobody knows. Nobody knows. The WHO has expressed its concern, and they have come out with guidelines for emergency ethics. Right? Emergency ethics as well. Is it really going to be something that is being tested only for, I mean, a patient or an individual who is submitting himself for testing of the drug? Will he be tested only for COVID vaccine or any other drug, any other medicine? Nobody knows. So this is again an erosion. In fact, the very COVID-19 outbreak is because of an unethical act of the laboratory in Wuhan. That is one of the theories. That's one of the theories which is strongly believed, and US is firmly saying that, United States of America is firmly saying that COVID-19 is a mutated form of SARS virus, and so it will be called as Wuhan virus. That's all diplomatic war going on between China and the United States of America, and this being election year of USA, you know very well what is happening. Now, this is a very important question of medical ethics. Are we human beings, as human beings, where are we heading? Are we becoming that cruel to trigger a disease to win politically and economically? If so, what is the idea of medical ethics? Is it really there? We have lost that. The organ transfer, organ theft, and making any patient who comes for any reason, calling him as a COVID patient and charging him more. And I just cannot imagine how come a hospital charge 18 lakhs for administering only paracetamol, which is costing you only 50 to 50 paise to 5 rupees maximum. So we are losing the medical ethics as such. Similarly, another important thing is the manner in which the lockdown was planned. Right? Next thing what we are losing is the freedom due to lockdown. We are losing freedom. See, freedom is an ethical value. Remember, freedom is an ethical value. If you look at the Constitution says we all have the right to freedom of speech, right to freedom of movement. Because freedom is something that is found in your mind. It's something which is it's a feeling. Freedom is a feeling. That's why you always say, feel free, feel at home. Freedom is not an adjunct. It's not an appendix. It is a feeling. We have lost freedom due to lockdown. Improper planning of the lockdown. On the one hand, lockdown is considered to be most successful one because we have broken the chain, and therefore the COVID spread has been limited, and India is not having as many cases as Europe had, and we are with this much of population, we have handled COVID very successfully. But on the other hand, we have to accept one important fact that we have achieved this at the cost of freedom. Right? We have achieved it at the cost of freedom. This lockdown has made the economically backward classes more economically backward but also economically destitute, right? More than COVID death. So on the one hand, we were more focusing on unifocusedly we were looking to the COVID cases, but we have not recognized, we have not looked into the deaths due to starvation, exhaustion, due to the lockdown related causes. You have lockdown, there are street dwellers, homeless people. They used to go and eat in the Amma hotel kind of canteens, Amma canteen, with a limited amount of money, whatever they can earn every day. But now, due to the lockdown, everything's closed. Did the government take that into account? Is it the way an ethical welfare government will do, welfare state will do? Is an important question. So we have lost the freedom, right? And I can give you the proof for this. See, more than 300 deaths. If you can see the date of the newspaper, it is May 2nd, 2020. Then, if you look at WHO's guidelines, the WHO's guidance for managing ethical issues in infectious disease outbreaks of 2016, it's a document. India is one of the signatories. And the Siracusa principles on limitation and derogation provisions of the in the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. They have told very clearly, for controlling the outbreak of any epidemic or a pandemic, the government is fully empowered to impose restrictions, but it should not be an infringement upon the rights of the people. There is a lot of difference between restriction and infringement. Right, there is a lot of difference between restriction and infringement. The government simply said, the Prime Minister came, appeared on the television. He said that we are going for a complete lockdown. What is lockdown? This is a concept that has been innovated and discovered now. Is it an emergency kind of situation? Almost so. It was a lockdown. You are not supposed to. The government was fixing to which shop you will go and buy your groceries, to which shop you will go and buy your vegetable requirements. On Sundays, nothing. And during the weekdays, morning from 7 to 11. And after that, you're not supposed to go out. And you cannot go by your four-wheeler. You cannot travel beyond 3 kilometers. You have to get an e-pass. Just imagine. It's absolute infringement. And still there is something called as Section 144 in vogue. You cannot go in group. See, all these things the government has taken. I may sound ridiculous, and you may feel that whatever, sir, you are talking too much. Whatever the government has done is for the welfare of the people. Yes, it is for the welfare of the people, no doubt. But remember, you and I, for whom the 3 square meals a day is assured, this is a very successful step to break the chain, control the spread of the disease. But think of people who are homeless. Think of people who are daily wages, migrant workers. There was no plan for them. To be precise, the Epidemic Diseases Act of 1897 and the Disaster Management Act. It is the Epidemic Diseases Act 1897 and the Disaster Management Act 2005 are the two acts based on which the lockdown was imposed. Section 2 of the Epidemic Diseases Act 1897 says very clearly the state has the power to regulate the freedom of movement, not even restrict. They say regulate. 19 Clause 5 of the Constitution provides for the grounds on which the right to freedom of movement guaranteed by 19 Clause 1 Subclass D can be restricted, and the ground is general public interest. This term general public interest is subject to very liberal interpretation, and based on this liberal interpretation, the lockdown was discovered and we are made to sit within the houses as though it was an emergency. Now you are unlocked. After 6 months, you understand very clearly. After 4 months, you understand very clearly that we have to learn to live with corona. Why do you have to do that? Why could not you have done that beforehand? The state has failed. They have not taken the moral responsibility. They have not taken the ethical responsibility. Remember, if you read the Constitution of India, you will understand one thing very clearly, that democracy for the Constitution of India is not a political concept, but it is an individual value. It is an ethical value for the state. That value we have lost. Policymakers, the rulers, they have comfortably overlooked that. As a result, citizens have lost the freedom. Remember, there is something called as social justice and reciprocity, which has to be taken into account while exercising the powers that are vested in the state by the Constitution itself. Even if the Constitution has vested in the state certain powers, while exercising the powers, you cannot exercise the power without considering social justice and reciprocity. Reciprocity means you are restricting the freedom of movement of the citizen. In turn, what are you going to give him? Remember, in India, the first COVID case was reported on 30th January 2020. Had the government of India been more considerate, more visionary, and had they been cautious, they could have stopped the international flights. They could have ensured the testing of the passengers who are traveling from abroad and reaching India, by which they could have controlled the COVID entering India itself. They overlooked it. Because of your carelessness and overlooking, you are going for a lockdown and people are accepting it because it is for their welfare. Now, what is that the government going to reciprocate to the citizens? This question is hanging, and there is no answer from any quarters for this question. This is the most important question, you know. See, in India kind of a country, the political socialization of the people are very, very low. Political socialization refers to your knowledge about the politics, rights, and how the government works. What are your rights and duties? What are your rights and responsibilities towards the society? The rate of political socialization is very low. Because of that reason, we are not able to demand the reciprocity from the government. Clear? The was lockdown, the question remains, was lockdown designed based on these considerations of social justice, reciprocity, etc.? It was more an infringement than restriction, especially with respect to the weak and vulnerable sections of the society. Remember, most of the times, we middle class do not have the empathy, or we don't think beyond us. That is a problem of middle class. Unfortunately, we have lost that freedom, and that freedom is lost to weak and vulnerable sections. In this entire lockdown phase, you can understand, you can find this. You would have found only this. The callous attitude of the state. On the one hand, the state was advocating frequent hand sanitization. But was there water supply ensured? It's important to have your hands sanitized, to have your hands washed. It is important to have water. But do you have, was there water supply? The reciprocity is more important. Think of the urban slums and remote villages. The lockdown related restrictions, the lockdown and the associated restrictions have caused the people to lose their livelihood. And another important thing, the state absolutely became a totalitarian state. The pandemic control was more done by policing than by reasonable restrictions. Where were the restrictions reasonable? Look at the way the society was responding. We were not only tolerating and passing over the high-handed behavior of the authorities. During the lockdown, there were several cases which was displayed. See, police were pranking, and police themselves took the video of they beating people and posting it in the social media. And what was our reaction to it? It is a barbaric act, unconstitutional act. But we not only tolerated it, we accepted that. Imagine what if this behavior continues after even COVID. In the long run, it will kill the democracy. There won't be any democracy at all. So the freedom is one important value. It has to be. Freedom is not elsewhere. Freedom is in our minds. It is in our minds. It is we who have to take the freedoms. See, if you look at the legal terminology, the fundamental right is known as private right. A private right is one that is enjoyed by an individual privately. I can only exercise my freedom of movement. You cannot exercise my freedom of movement. If I were to move, then I have to move. And that freedom is more in the minds. The freedom is our right. Remember, we generally tend to say that we are right to movement. It is not right to movement. It is a right to freedom of movement. So freedom is a mindset. It is a value. Comfortably, that value is kept under dormancy. And once it becomes dormant, and if it is not attended to, remember, it will die. It will die its own natural death. It will be buried. And after having buried freedom, what kind of democracy are you going to operate? It's a very important question that is hanging in front of us. The next thing what we have lost here is the transparency. Mind it, this transparency is not an issue of India alone, but it is a global phenomenon. Across the globe, the governments have preferred to keep the COVID-related news and their capability to being prepared to handle COVID as a top secret. It is funny to hear that the medical professionals and hospital staffs were punished for disclosing the weaknesses and lack of equipment in the hospital in America. You can click this link, you can understand. This is the news. The Times newspaper reported. Nurses and doctors speaking out on safety now risk their job. Quite ridiculous. So transparency. See, COVID has revealed one important thing, that the governments were unprepared. Because of their slackness and unpreparedness, if the theory of Wuhan laboratory unleashing COVID becomes true, COVID-19 is nothing but a bioterrorism and a bio war. We know, see, the terms bioterrorism and biowar are not new. During 1990s, there were anthrax spores being sent to people through post. Biowar. We know the biowar. Having known that it is possible, why the governments were not prepared for that? And in order to avoid being questioned, see, remember, transparency and accountability go hand in hand. When you want to avoid accountability, you have to kill transparency. That's it. Because being transparent by itself is being accountable. Moment you are transparent, you become accountable. Now, when I want to avoid accountability, I have to kill transparency. That's it. Very easy to avoid accountability is to kill transparency. That's exactly what the governments did. And the same thing happened in India as well. Think of the controversies that was looming around the PM Care Fund. There are several funds, PM's Calamity Relief Fund, Disaster Management Fund. Why do we have another fund? What is being told and what has actually happened? There are differences which are not answered. Let me not harp on this particular point more because it will take a political turn. I'm just putting a fact before you. And the next important thing is the loss of the constitutional value called federalism. Federalism is under challenge. COVID gave us an opportunity to prove to the world and to ourselves that cooperative federalism is workable. The concept of cooperative federalism is one that was envisaged by the founding fathers of the Indian Constitution. A federal government is one, or a federalism is a system wherein there will be two governments, one federal government or the union government, central government, and the governments of the states. And these governments will have exclusive jurisdictions. They have subject matters upon which the union government will have the power to make law and implement, and there are subject matters in which the state governments will have the power to make law and implement. And these are exclusive jurisdictions. The union government shall not encroach upon the state subjects, and the state government shall not encroach upon the union subjects. This is what is an ideal federalism known as. As far as India is concerned, the founding fathers of the Constitution wanted India to be a cooperative federalism, meaning the federalism in India must operate on the basis of the cooperation between the union government and the state government. Now you may ridicule me again, you may doubt, sir, as far as the COVID control is concerned, both the union and the state governments were totally working hand in hand. They were cooperating with each other. Remember, the cooperation was enforced. Cooperation has to be voluntary. How was the decision of lockdown came? See, lockdown was not only a surprise to us, but surprises to state government as well. Even the state governments came to know that the country is going for a lockdown only when the Prime Minister announced it. And so the very idea of federalism is challenged, and we are more moving towards centralizing tendency. Federalism is a form of government which focuses on local autonomy. On the one hand, we are advised to think locally and act locally. On the other hand, the government is more becoming centralized. The transference of power, the devolution of power to the local areas is an important aspect of federalism. Unfortunately, that is not happening. The very decision of lockdown was taken by the union government, and it was imposed on the states. The states had no other go but only to accept it. Initially, the states like Andhra Pradesh reacted, but they also fell in line because of the gravity of COVID. The Andhra chief minister said COVID is nothing but a small fever, and you can ordinary fever with a paracetamol, you can go and work. But later he understood the importance. The gravity is something different. And using this opportunity, the government is centralizing. Think of the laws that have been passed during the COVID. There have been many laws that have been passed in the Parliament of India without public opinion, without getting the state's opinion, they have been passed. So the federalism is being killed. Another important aspect at the social level is the concept of work-life balance being forgotten. In the COVID and ethics, what we gained, we saw that family and other stuff. That was only during the first 3 months of lockdown. After 3 months, the concept of work from home was discovered, and it became very fancy. But unfortunately, this concept has killed and taken away the very idea of work-life balance. The idea of work-life balance demands that the work and work-life and the social life should be separated. But unfortunately, the COVID has brought work to home. Right? As far as I am concerned, I am against the concept of homework to children. If a child goes to the school, he should learn anything and everything within the school hours, do the job over there, come home, play well. What did Bharatiyar say? The whole evening should be devoted for playing. But what do? They give homework. It is not homework for the child. It is not the work to be done by the child at home. It is the work that is to be done by the people at home. It's absurd. And where is the work-life balance for the child in that case? Today, the houses don't have bedrooms, drawing rooms, living rooms. The living room becomes the office room of the father. One of the bedroom becomes a classroom for the brother. And another bedroom becomes a classroom for the sister or the younger brother. And where is the bedroom? Now, all of us are sitting at our home, I suppose, attending this lecture. I am sitting in my living room. I am monopolizing this room. Nobody will be allowed to come here because I am into a very serious business. Is it really that worthwhile to compromise your home? But unfortunately, we have done that. Remember, initial stages, work from home concept will be very beneficial. You don't have to travel. They will justify this way. You don't have to travel. Because you don't have to travel, your physical movement is restricted. Your productivity energy will be more. So thirdly, you will not be exposed to the polluted environment, air polluted, noise polluted. Then the fuel, you will not burn the fossil fuel, driving your car here and there, going to your office and contributing to the ecological fragility. All these are fancy ideas, don't purchase. Again, let me tell you, human beings are human beings. Men, human beings have to interact with people. The Harvard Women's Health Watch study, recent study, 2020 study, sorry, 2019 study. It says social interaction is essential for development of IQ and for the better mental health. And they have found that people who interact with more number of people or persons who interact with more number of people are happier than people who sit aloof. Their mental alertness is much better than people who sit alone. And solitudeness, isolating oneself from the society, is a symbol of depression. It's a state of mental illness. It's a beginning of mental illness. When you have a problem, what do? Just imagine. Normally, what is your tendency? We go sit alone. We want to walk away. We want to go to the beach. Fine. You go there looking to divert your mind, clear it off and come back. Fine. Otherwise, you have to go and talk to somebody. You have to pull it out. And for children, the screen time of the children is more today. At a point in time, you said no phones into the school. Today, the school is in the phone. Isn't it? Instead of making children smarter, the schools are conducted in the smartphones. It's impacting the children more. Their physical and real-time interaction with their fellow children is lost today. When we were children, when I was a child, I will be, if I'm not at home, then you can find me in my school. Remember, I am very clear. You can find me in my school, not in my classroom. For me, school is different and class is different. I am known for cutting the class, but I will never get out of the school. I'll be found in the playground. The sense of belongingness, what we had with the school. Do we have now? No. And sitting in home, looking into the screen, virtual classrooms. What is the purpose of school? Morning, you wake up at a particular time, get yourself ready, whereby you are getting to understand the importance of personal hygiene, regularity, personal hygiene, and school is a society in the miniature. There are 50 children from 50 different family backgrounds come, where you will go, you are forced to share and care. You have to adjust. You have to tolerate somebody. Then you have to read people, understand what frequency matches, then become friends, play, then dealing with elders other than belonging to your family, acculturation takes place. That's why schools and college, schools or education institutions are known as a secondary institutions of socialization. That's lost. Socialization phenomenon is very important for the transference of value and also the development of psychological strength. That's the reason why we always say that read novels, watch movies. The characters in the movies, the characters in the novel tell you what kind of persons you are going to meet in the society in your lifetime. That is lost because of the doing away with the concept of work-life balance by the work-from-home concept. Now, the father will not go out. He will look into the computer. Look, the longer screen time will make you to become more tired. More tired, you become more wild. And confining to one particular place, 24 hours, it's not going to work. So we have lost the idea of work life. We have forgotten that, which is very dangerous in the long run. And another important thing, most important, is the privacy. Today we are into a digital highway. We are into digital governance. And for COVID also, as usual, we have the digital monitoring and contact tracing applications like Arogya Sedu. This Arogya Sedu app collects something called as personally identifiable information. I hope you know what is this personally identifiable information. A personally identifiable information is one information by which you can understand the personal information relating to an individual. What his interests are, what he eats, where he goes, where all he frequents, which websites he frequently watch, which bank he has account. These are all the personally identifiable informations. The personally identifiable informations are, so remember, that is the most important thing. You must have come across the problems of using social media. People always say, don't share your PIN number. Don't take a photograph of your credit card and send it to somebody because it contains personal information. We have the Arogya Sedu. Today, because of this COVID, we also did not bother. We downloaded Arogya Sedu app. When you want to travel by flight, they say that you have to have Arogya Sedu, get a COVID test, upload it, update it, whatever it is. And that is being stored in a database. Where is the guarantee for the data protection? Even during the Aadhaar, when the Aadhaar law was enacted and the Aadhaar law was challenged in the court of law, the question was about the data protection. Have we developed a data protection system which will guarantee an impeccable data protection for us? Do we have a clearly transparent, clear and transparent system regarding this? Remember, in the garb of COVID control, in the garb of COVID protocol, the intrusion into somebody's privacy is justified. And people are made to accept it. And we have comfortably accepted it without realizing the danger involved. What are the dangers? If the corrupt use of the data is more likely, there is no measure or assurance to prevent that. What if the private corporates may get the data through corrupt means and use it to target sell their products. Now, I'm not telling you what you don't know. Is your mobile number private to you only? How many spam messages you are getting every day? Everything is interconnected. You have a smartphone. See, today there are only two types of slaves in the world today. Either you have to be a Google slave or you have to be an iOS, Apple slave. You use iOS, Apple phone, you're an Apple slave. If you are using an Android phone, you're a Google slave. And whatever data your email ID is connected to your phone to activate your smartphone, you need an email ID, and your email ID is connected to your Facebook, and your Facebook is connected to your WhatsApp is connected to every damn thing. Which means, where is your privacy? With the IMEI number of your phone, I can trace the phone where it is. Or in the Apple iPhone, there is a app called Locate My Phone, Find My Phone. If your phone has Find My Phone option on, if your location services of Google is on, it's very easy for me to locate you. I can trace you. I can track you. Where is the privacy? Over and above that, for COVID measures, you are taking up the personally identifiable information. And remember, there is again a political connotation for that. What if the state used this data to monitor and conduct surveillance against dissidents and political rivals of the ruling party? If tomorrow we all have Arogya Setu, and if the government decides to monitor us, what will you do? Cambridge Analytica scandal. I hope you understand. And another important thing is the poor and pitiable sections of the society, the street vendors, transgenders, commercial sex workers, refugees from different countries, they were all forgotten. They were all forgotten. In Bangalore, there was a news wherein the commercial sex workers died out of starvation because there were no customers due to COVID. Even HIV, which is a sexually transmitted disease, or any other sexually transmitted disease, had not made the commercial sex workers to die out of starvation, but COVID has made them. Now, if you look at from the so-called social moral perspective, then I may sound very odd. Sir, you are talking for commercial sex workers, let them die. After all, they are not required for the society. They are a black mark for the society. You may feel that is not the right thing. That's not the right way to approach. According to the constitution, irrespective of what work you do, it is moral responsibility of the state to protect them. And why somebody takes to commercial sex work is a very seriously discussable and debatable issue later. That's absolutely a separate topic. And what happens to transgenders? They are already destitute. The families don't own them. They've been driven away. And refugees. So we were more oriented towards our own goods and our own welfare, inward looking. But we have lost these aspects with respect to ethical framework of the society during the COVID. And my time is limited, and therefore I had to go with this much only, but yet it's too long a presentation. Today it is said that in the recent context, it is said that a good presentation should not exceed beyond 10 to 15 slides, but yet I have made it 30. And I hope you also enjoyed whatever I told you and whatever we discussed. And I am ready to take the questions from you. And thank you very much before that from my side for patiently listening to me. And thank you again to CARE for giving me the opportunity. Now we can discuss if you have any questions.
Thank you, Ganesha sir. And very mesmerizing speech and very commendable, strong, simple delivery. Easy, understandable.
Thank you,
sir. Yes, lockdown was a good teacher, infused very tough lessons in a short period of 3 to 4 months. We have learned very tough lessons.
Yes.
Okay. and refreshed us about what COVID has given and lost. And now we can go to question answer session. Participants can either raise their hands or ask their questions in the chat box.
Yeah, Mr. Prasad Rao, you can speak now.
Yeah. Good evening, Mr. Ganesh.
Yes,
sir. A wonderful session. It is a very, very simple message that you have given, like what we gained and what we lost. Especially the last slide was a very punching one. The role and responsibility of all the people to all the people. That is the one thing what I really liked it. The message was very, very simple that it was touching everybody. My best wishes to you, sir. This is very, very, very much needed for the day. I wish you all the best.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Nice. Wonderful.
And there is a message from Tamil Union. Excellent and practical speech, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
And from Somo, dear sir, nice session. Even tough, we passed on every situation. Certain things were already forgotten.
Yes.
And after a long time also, we live with families. Actually, before we don't talk with the children. Normally, yeah. They go to school, come and again go to tuition. But we nowadays, we spend a lot of time with the children. So nowadays, we got nice time to correct the children's values.
Yes.
And from Ravi Chakkalangam, sir, interesting and informative.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Excellent narration. Krishnamurthy, sir, any other questions?
No question. We can move on to next.
Okay. So here we move on to our next announcement. Next announcement is as usual, Learn with Care. All our CARE programs are uploaded in our YouTube channel, CARE HRD for Success. You can make use of it. Your missed programs can also be watched formally. Pudichirundha like pannunga, share pannunga, subscribe pannunga, engala encourage pannunga. And our next announcement is about our next program, and it is very interesting topic. Vandirunga participants, adu oru kalanduraiyadal nigalchi. Thalaippu vandu kudumbamum samoogamum by Mr. Ravi Chokkalingam sir, senior quality manager from Dubai, along with our energetic Ms. Ulagammal counseling and psychotherapist, educational counselor on November 1st Sunday at 10:45 a.m. Time ku join pannidunga participants. Seviki nalla unavu kaathu kondirukirathu. விட்டு விடாதீர்கள். And next is vote of thanks by our own MC Sahana. Over to you, Sahana.
Okay, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, Sahana.
Yes,
okay, thank you, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. It gives me immense pleasure to convey my heartfelt gratitude to our today's speaker, Mr. Ganesh Subramanian, for such a wonderful session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Also, I take this opportunity to thank Dr. Kamala Kannan for wonderful inaugural address with an interesting introduction to the chief guest. Thank you, ma'am. I'm also glad to thank our technical team for their never-ending support. Thank you, Mr. Bala Subramaniam and Sankara Subramaniam. Also, take this opportunity to thank our media partner, Success Media. And a great thanks to our coordinator, Mrs. Geeta Palaniappan, for being such an interactive host. Thank you, ma'am. And a great thanks to our CARE designer, Mr. Nandanan. A special thanks to our founder director CARE, Dr. R. Krishnamurthy, and joint director CARE, Mr. S. Balachandar, for taking the society towards development through CARE. Last but not least, I thank all our participants for all their constant support. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much for the
Thank you, Sahana. Thank you, Sahana. Thank you, sir. Hope today's takeaway from Ganesha, sir, was useful. Signing off for today. See you all on Sunday at 10:45 a.m. Till then, it's bye from CARE. Take care.